Hello, I'm Dr. Nick Delgado with Nick TV, and I'm here to share with you an exciting opportunity to hear from one of the greats in health and in medicine, and now pretty much in helping people with their emotional adjustment to following a balanced life. Dr. Joseph Maroon is the author of Square One, and we're really excited to hear if you can get that on the image there, share that with the audience. Dr. Joseph Maroon, let's start with something important. What do you do, and how do you go about your daily life? Are you still seeing patients? I understand you work with a major football team. You work with a university. Give me an idea of what is Dr. Joseph Maroon's week like? What do you do?
Well, I'm still very active. Thank you, Nick. And I'm a full-time neurosurgeon at the University of Pittsburgh. So I'm performing 5 to 10 operations a week. I see 40 to 50 patients. And I'm very active in research. I'm very fortunate to be and do what I do. I work with the Pittsburgh Steelers, as we discussed, as a consultant and neurosurgeon, evaluating concussions, neck injuries, spine injuries, and consulting with the WWE, World Wrestling Entertainment, as well, helping these athletes. So I'm very involved with athletics personally, as well as in my practice, and maintain, like you, you're my hero in terms of a role model of physical fitness, still competing in triathlons, and working out at least an hour a day.
Dr. Joseph Maroon, what is your biggest life lesson? What have you learned from life that you want to share with our audience in probably writing your book, but what is so important to you in life?
Well, I think it's about the basics, Nick. I went through medical college, undergrad, Indiana University, medical school, neurosurgical residency, fellowships, practiced neurosurgery for about 10 years very actively. And the biggest life lesson came from failure. When I say failure, I was chief of neurosurgery at one of the university hospitals doing brain surgery and writing papers, doing research. And within a few weeks, my father died. My wife left with two children, and I had to quit neurosurgery all of the same week. When my father died, he left my mother and me a dilapidated truck stop in Wieland, West Virginia. And I had my emotional reserve was gone. I could no longer practice neurosurgery, and I went from 1 week doing brain surgery to the next week literally filling up 18-wheelers and flipping hamburgers in a dilapidated truck stop in the middle of winter.
Oh, my God.
So when you say, what's my biggest life lesson? The biggest life lesson was somehow finding a way back from very severe depression and emotional exhaustion. It was really the epitome of burnout. And as you know, in physicians, burnout occurs in about 50% of us, and in the general population, approximately a third of individuals, lawyers, engineers, and other professions, experience burnout. So the biggest life lesson was struggling not only to survive, but to find a way back to a functional existence. And that's what the book, Square One, A Simple Guide to a Balanced Life, is all about. It's about the formula that I rediscovered that enabled me to kind of pick up the pieces, get back to my profession, and subsequently actually thrive and continue to practice at a very high level, adhering to the principles that I outline in the book.
Dr. Maroon, may I say you're in your seventh decade of life? Is that close to? And yeah. That being said, Here's a man who overcame horrendous challenges, emotional, your wife leaving, your father dying, having to inherit a business that was falling apart. And, you know, all these challenges hit you at once. And here you're a single father all of a sudden. And me as well, being a single father, I certainly understand, with five children, ages 8 to 38, having met Isabella. Where is Isabella today? Where is she at?
My beautiful daughter Isabella is in the School of the Art Institute in Chicago, finishing her senior year, and who knows what after that, but she's enjoying it very much now.
Well, I got to meet her in Las Vegas early in one of the medical conferences, and then as recent as this December, we got to reconnect with you and Isabella, and we did a blood morphology oxidative stress test, and you told me something special that she put on her wall there. What is that?
Well, we were delighted that you were able to analyze her blood as you did, and I actually took pictures, I must say, a little surreptitiously while you were examining her, of both of you and her blood slides on a wide screen, and copied it, photographed it, blew it up, and put it in a room in a frame.
Well, us doctor scientists would appreciate the inner universe of the blood. I mean, we look up into the skies, the moon, and the stars, but equally impressive is that inner universe of the blood and the blood morphology and the circulation and everything that takes place internally. And of course, internally, is it possible that one of the ways you were able to deal with the life challenges was you learned about adrenal function, adrenal fatigue, how to prompt and promote the androgens and testosterone balance with cortisol, and what to do about estrogen imbalances. Hormones play a big role in men in their 50s, 60s, 70s, as well as in women, don't they?
Nick, that's an incredibly perspicacious question. Keenly aware of physiology and the brain-mind, the mind-body connection. When I was living literally in a farmhouse down in West Virginia, overlooking the dilapidated truck stop, my immune system, because of the depression, was so suppressed that I contracted infectious hepatitis from the food in the truck stop.
Oh, wow.
And one day I noticed my conjunctiva being quite yellow, feeling terrible, and my liver enzymes were off the chart. So because of the stress, my cortisol level was so elevated that it suppressed my immune system. And I contracted hepatitis, which was added to the problem. So that one of the things that people overlook is the fact that severe depression depletes it actually kills brain cells, particularly in the hippocampus, the area of the brain that subserves memory. It leads to osteoporosis. It leads to various skin disorders. It's a very debilitating process because of the endocrine factors that you just mentioned that occur in terms of the fight or flight response. The body becomes exhausted hormonally as well as emotionally and physically, which leads to the debilitating effects that occurs with such problems.
Dr. Maroon, not many physicians are educated about how do you deal with, even endocrinologists dealing with adrenal fatigue, chronic fatigue, depression. We see our movie stars, our celebrities developing excessive habits of addictions and drug addictions and food addictions. And it's really tragic and sad. And I think one of the missions of worldhealth.net, of course, we're both part of, is to really educate people. And with my website, nickdelgado.com, and your website, josephmaroon.com, I think people are starting to hear and understand that they don't feel alone any longer. It's not in their head, just an emotional thing that someone needs to give them a prescription psychiatric drug. It's truly a deeper level that at the hormonal level, the quality of your sleep, the ability to dissipate stress and turn stress into zest and learn from our experiences. So this is probably the greatest subject that you've ever written, is a simple guide to balance life, the square one. I mean, this is a great work. I'm sure it's somewhat cathartic to write the book, but at the same time, you're giving gems and golden tips about the four steps of the body, the brain, the heart, the soul. Tell me about what happened during the course of this, I would consider overcoming huge hurdles, but to overcome and then come about writing what is quickly going to become my favorite book. Tell me about this process.
Well, thank you very much. Nick, again, I admire and respect very much your knowledge in this field and how to treat it and the incredible frustration dealing with not only with our patients, but with our family members who often experience the same thing. Yes. Eating disorders, problems with obsessive compulsive desires of all sizes, all kinds, addictions. And many doctors, unfortunately, believe that depression is a deficiency of Prozac. But it's true.
You're right.
The first thing that they reach for is a prescription for a SSRI, an antidepressant. And this is, I think, if there's any lessons that I can convey to our audience and to my patients, is that it's back to basics. It's back to simplicity. So what are the basics? And the basics are very clearly physical exercise, the controlling stress through spirituality, meditation, yoga, and about good, healthy diet. These factors alone, which I detail quite detail in the book, are ways of overcoming many addictions and stresses and getting back to a balanced life. I mean, it's getting back to the basics. And we know in head-to-head studies with patients who are depressed, put on antidepressants versus a rigorous exercise program of 45 minutes to an hour a day, the exercise always, virtually always, is better than the antidepressants in moderate depression. In severe, you may need the kind of chemical help. But for mild to moderate depression, as I outline, the approach, I believe, is with physical activity, exercise program. And that's how I discovered this. If I may just digress a second, you know,
please.
I was in the midst of terrible depression, thinking all sorts of destructive thoughts. And I picked up the book, I Dare You, by the author, William Danforth, who outlined the concept of the square. And a local banker who held the mortgage to the truck stop called me and said, "Joe, let's go for a run." I said, "Run? I'm 20 pounds overweight. I can't walk up a flight of stairs, and you want me to run?" But he cajoled and twisted my arm, and we went around the track four times. I was exhausted. But that night was the first night I slept in about 3 months.
Wow.
So the light bulb went off. I went back the next day and did a mile and a half, and then 2 miles, and then 3 miles. And my depression started to lift. I ate better. I lost weight naturally, not with drugs or pills. And then I got back to spirituality in terms of my Catholic upbringing, and got into Bible, meditation, prayer. And the four sides of my square, the physical side, the spiritual side, the family, social, came into balance. And I realized that my life should not be committed totally to my work, which is what led to the complete catastrophe that I experienced. And the other important point, I had no insight into how I got there. I'm working in a truck stop, filling up 18-wheelers, and how, you know, something's wrong with this picture. How did this happen? And I had no insight that it was my crazy obsession with work and my own ego that got me into that situation. So that's what I try to detail to help others.
Well, that's profound. You know, it's difficult because while we're in the middle of our life, this little voice in the head, but often it's the silence between the voices that really are you. And we have to be careful to filter through what our thoughts are. And it's often been said we have 60,000 thoughts a day, but many of them are negative, and we have to really steer our mind. And one of the ways is through movement, our body starts to function at an emotional and a spiritual level, at a better level. That's exciting. And I read the section in your book where you experienced with your daughter, Isabella, the accomplishment of of scaling, climbing Mount Kilimanjaro, 19,300 feet, and you were sharing with me the hypoxia, the lack of oxygen at high levels. I use a cyclic variation adaptive conditioner where it takes me up 20,000 feet, drops at 1,000 feet per second to stimulate my mitochondria and my immune system and my EPO, erythropoietin, but it changes. It goes up temporarily, then comes down. You were up on that mountain. It's cold. It's high up. You're having difficulty breathing. You got to be in great shape. So taking from when you're barely getting around the track four times to climbing and scaling that mountain, what was that experience like and what did it mean to you and Isabella?
Well, Nick, the most important aspect is how I got there. You know, why in the world did I even do this? And I go back, after running around that track, I was eventually able to do a mini triathlon and then a major triathlon. And I've completed now 8 Ironman triathlons, 5 in Hawaii, in Kona. And in 2010, I quit. It's a 140-mile race, and I was on the last 10 miles of the marathon, and I heard behind me click, 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 getting closer. And I was ready to drop out, and a hand touched me on my shoulder and said, "Hey, 227, you can't quit yet. You're only 10 miles from the finish. Come on, follow me." And I thought this guy was out of his mind. He had no idea how I felt. Then a car came the opposite direction. It was pitch black in the lava fields. And it shined its lights on this fellow, and he had no legs and one arm. It was Rajesh Dubal, the first triple amputee to finish the Hawaiian Ironman. And we subsequently met afterwards, which I detail in the book. And 2 years later, he called me and he said, "Joe, I need a physician to join me in a group of differently enabled athletes, not disabled, differently enabled athletes to climb Mount Kilimanjaro, and you've been nominated." So I thought about it. I asked Isabella and I said, "Okay, we'll go." Well, these differently enabled athletes, two of them had one leg, one had no arms, one had one arm, and then Rajesh, no legs and one arm. So here I am, getting blisters on my feet as we climb up the mountain. And these fellows take their prostheses off and look at their bloody stumps and say nothing about it. Say nothing. They're smiling. They're laughing. They're happy. Gosh. So, you know, my mother used to say I cried because I had no shoes until I met a man who had no feet. And here I am with the guys with no arms and no legs climbing a mountain. So it was probably the most humbling experience of my life to climb that mountain with these fellows whose attitude was the motto of the climb was one's altitude is determined by one's attitude. Wow. And that's what it was all about. So it was a great honor and opportunity to join these fellows in the climb.
Yeah, in 1978, I met Bob Wieland, a double amputee. And he came to an event where I was speaking with over 500 people in the audience, and he rolled up in his wheelchair at the end of my event, and he said, "I want to do what you're doing. I want to present. I want to be a speaker. Can you train me?" And I looked at Bob Wieland, and I said, "Yes, I would be more than happy. I don't view you as a person who's disabled, but I do have a comment. You're severely overweight. You need to look the part if you're going to be a health educator and a speaker. And I challenge you to follow," at that time, an oil-free vegan, Nathan Pritikin. I was working with him at the time. And I challenged him, and he within 9 months, he not only was a great seminar speaker with us, he would go to events, and he had dropped over 100 pounds following the program and gotten great, phenomenal shape. He broke a world record in bench press, lifting over 500 pounds against able body athletes with no legs. He couldn't even touch the ground because he had no legs. And he walked across America on his hands, a double amputee. Wow. Took him 3.5 years. He also has biked across America back and forth with the hand pedal arm without legs twice, traversing all of America. He's been in the Ironman triathlon. And like you said, I never since 1978, in nearly 38 years that I've known him, ever heard him complain, make excuses. Here he was, a veteran from Vietnam who lost his legs, came back with a baseball contract to play for Pittsburgh, Pittsburgh Phillies, is it? And what is it?
Pirates. Pittsburgh Pirates.
Yeah. Is there also Philadelphia Phillies?
Yes.
Okay, it was Philadelphia Phillies. And he could have been depressed. He could have given up on life. He could have said, hey, I'll just stay on welfare as a veteran. No, he came to me and became one of the great speakers of our time. And to this day, he's an incredible inspiration going to churches, colleges, universities. And I think that, you know, there's a time where you have to compare what you were dealt in life. Not everyone watching the show was dealt a fair hand. Some people have disabilities. Some have differently enabled talents. Here you are, a talented man, went through medical school. You're a neurologist. You're the team physician for a famous football team. And, you know, there's probably some other people that inspire you as well. Tell me about the people that have inspired you and, you know, and then let's move around with that idea. Are there inspirational people in your life?
Yeah, there are quite a few, actually. I think probably one of the most inspirational was Chuck Knoll, who was the head coach for the Pittsburgh Steelers. He won 4 Super Bowls. And one of the most inspirational individuals I've ever had the opportunity to work with or know. And Chuck's role, I mean, his motto was, you know, football is not complicated, just like life. It's about blocking and tackling. And life, we make it complicated. it's not that complicated if you adhere to regular exercise, a healthy diet, avoiding environmental toxins, and controlling stress. Those are the basics. And so he's one. And then I've had many, many teachers. I studied at the University of Oxford in England under a man by the name of Joe Pennybacker, who was a brilliant neurosurgeon, a pioneer, a leader, and a very big inspiration in my own life in terms of excellence and always looking to do things better. Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi, the individual who wrote the book Flow, The Ultimate Psychological Experience, that you know all about in terms of, you know, he said the greatest moments of our lives are when our mind or our body is stretched to its limits in the voluntary pursuit of something both difficult and worthwhile. So it's when we push ourselves and, you know, we never know what our limits are till we try to exceed them. But it's when we push ourselves that we get that flow experience, whether it's, for me, it's doing surgery. Your time becomes suspended. You forget your bodily functions. You're focused intently on what you're doing. Painting, piano, rock climbing, whatever, weightlifting, running, a runner's high. This flow experience, I also describe in the book. And these are the kinds of inspirational things that motivate me still.
Yeah, it's really an impressive school of work that you've put together. And, you know, inspiration is partly perspiration and determination and focus. And I often think when I'm lifting my dumbbells nonstop, you know, it's kind of a lifter's high where you get a runner's high. And I love competing against these big monster giant athletes and really being able to go head to head. And it's a mental and a physical thing that you go through. But also, I think you have to elevate your body and your mind above and really think through, you know, what is this challenge that I'm up against? You've had some big challenges in your life. What's the deepest regret that you've ever dealt with?
I regret, it's a double-edged sword, Nick. I regret the neglect, the intense intensity with which I pursued work. I regret it in the sense that it cost me dearly in terms of my family, my emotional health, my physical health. But, you know, there's a saying that adversity is the best teacher, and that which does not kill me makes me stronger. So, you know, in one sense, what turned out to be the worst experience of my life, helped me learn lessons that maybe and hopefully I can share with others and help them lead a more balanced life and recover from adversity and from depression.
So in an individual that's seeking excellence and perfection, one rule that I've tended to rehearse, and that is some of the greatest and most successful individuals on the planet learn to deal with failure in a different way. They would gain the learnings from their failure, of which they would let go and redevelop their strategy or their approach. And they started thinking about systems. I'm a big believer in rituals and systems. I mean, I literally carry my food with me. I carry fresh fruits and vegetables. I think underneath I have something here. I have my Slim Blend. I have my supplement pack. I follow these rituals so that every day I know I'm getting lots of fresh fruits and vegetables, oil-free, whole, rich in nutrients and phytochemicals. I know Isabella is going in that direction as well. What do you think about that kind of whole food, vegan, oil-free, gluten-free type lifestyle? What do you think about that?
Well, I totally subscribe to it myself. I as much vegetables as I possibly can, lean meat, high fiber, various types of supplements, some of which include yours. So I definitely subscribe to that. But I was just listening to you say that. I'm thinking, you know, a lot of people I know would say this guy really has a bad problem with OCD. And I'm the same way. There's no question. But I think we're compulsive about good things. Yeah. And that's how I look at it. Yeah, it sounds crazy. A lot of people say, why do you work out an hour every day? Why do you do triathlons at your age? Well, I know that it keeps my brain sharp. It keeps my reflexes in tune. I wouldn't be able to do what I do today unless I follow the dietary and the physical regimen and the stress reduction things that I do, just like you.
Yeah, there's a book by Scott Jurek, Eat and Run, and he talks about raw vegan food and running ultra marathons. And I'm wondering, what books have you referenced? First, let's start with the health area and then work up to the spiritual area. You mentioned flow, but are there some health books that you like? And
Yeah. You know, there are a couple, seven, there are many actually. You know, the first comes to mind is David Pearlmutter. Uh-huh. You know, I know David, he's a very prominent neurologist in Naples, Florida, and his book, Grain Brain.
Yep, so gluten-free.
I think it's a very popular one now. Daniel Amen, psychiatrist in California, has written many books on brain health, a better brain, a better body. I think Joseph Ledoux, a neurophysiologist and scientist at the Rockefeller Institute, in terms of the emotional brain, you know, and I'm kind of drawn to those books that help to explain the biochemistry, what happens in our brain with exercise. You know, we no one thinks that you really make a hormone by the name of BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which actually creates new brain cells, new synapses, and increases neuroplasticity. So, you know, books along these lines I'm drawn to.
I like to spend time with my 8-year-old because he sees the humor in life. He's laughing constantly. And they say that young people, you know, age one to eight, you know, they laugh a lot and they really look in for humor in life. And as we get older, we don't laugh as often. We don't smile as often. So being humorous, creative, and flow in your chapter 9, I think this is one of the most valuable chapters because you can accomplish things in your life. You can be successful in your business, making money. You can even achieve physical prowess. But if you're not emotionally happy and humorous and creative, you're missing out on a huge part of life, aren't you?
There's no question about that. And the problem, as you well know, it's how to motivate people when they get into a lifetime bad habits, Nick. They don't realize how good they can actually feel if they do the right thing. They start to accept mediocrity. They start to accept being sad or depressed. And they don't want to or can't make the effort to pull out of the doldrums, so to speak. And I was that way myself. I know what it feels like. And exercise saved my life. That started me back, because then I lost weight unintendedly. It was a side effect of doing the right thing. You lose weight, your brain neuropeptides and neurochemicals get back in store. Your serotonin levels get improved without taking drugs. And your heart, your bones, everything works better. But you have to just somehow get to that point to try it. You know, try it, you'll like it.
It's resonated with me. I'm inspired. I think I'm going to grab my set of dumbbells that I carry in the trunk of my car here in between segments. And, you know, I've got my mini trampoline with bungee cords, so it challenges my balance while I'm lifting. I get some lymphatic stimulation. I even have an infrared spa upstairs in my office. I'll stop in there and do a little detox while I read the text for my next interview. But, you know, I think I lived a balanced and blessed life. I'm certainly not a person that is afraid to take on challenges. And at the same time, I take time to be with my kids. Four of my five children work with my business. I get to interact with them on a daily and regular basis. And they each have kind of dubbed off into their own encouragement, their own inspiration, their own purpose. And, you know, I want to be that guiding light, as you have become for so many people. And the fact that you've come out in your book and shared your personal life story and some of the challenges and setbacks, I think, you know, it's when you share your deeper inner challenges and then you overcome adversity. I know when I talk to my clients who are in their 70s and 80s and 90s, they say, Nick, you're just a pup. You're 62. Wait till you hit 72. Wait till you hit 82. Wait till you hit 92. And I'm looking for 102 and above. So we've got to strengthen our mind and our body and our spirit and bring the whole nation together to deal with this national health debt and really work together as a nation, as probably the early days when President Kennedy was around. You go back that far. I think we need to pull the nation together as well, don't you?
Well, Nick, your passion, your verve, and your example. You know, we lead and teach by example. And the things that you do in your own life, the family, the stress relieving factors that comes from interacting with your kids and your family, your physical activity, your nutritional programs, these are all things. You're doing the right thing, and I don't think you always were there. I think this is something that you've evolved to yourself. So we're both extremely blessed and fortunate to be able to share our own personal experiences with others, and it's great in giving. You know, it's in giving that we receive, and I love that.
And it's been a pleasure. Once again, that website, Dr. Maroon, is for you.
MaroonSquareOne.com.
Yep, that's for the book, and you have a website, josephmaroon.com, and we'll have you on a guest very soon. So what are your predictions for the Super Bowl, Joseph? What do you think?
Well, obviously I want the Steelers to go all the way. There are a few small impediments like Boston and Kansas City in our way, but hope and pray.
Well, I was at the Chargers game with the Chiefs, San Diego Chiefs, that is the Kansas City Chiefs. And, you know, professional football is a joy to watch. I go back to the Joe Namath day, New York Jets, watching him, and the Los Angeles Rams when they had the fearsome foursome. So you and I both started out in Pop Warner football. You have some exciting stories back to the day. Don't you think some of that core basis that you gained, your determination and your ability to overcome adversity, started out with possibly sports and Pop Warner football?
I wouldn't be on this show with you, Nick, if I hadn't participated in Pop Warner football. It's a fact. The lessons learned on the fields of friendly strife are lessons that you carry over the rest of your life in everything you do. You don't quit. It's teamwork. It's leadership. It's doing the right thing at the right time. Loyalty, friendship. These are the things that really lead to success. And a good life.
And it could be soccer, it could be wrestling, it could be basketball. I mean, John Wooden built a dynasty with the core of building the values of his pyramid to success and his principles of success. Certainly one of the great coaches in history, John Wooden at UCLA. And USC did a pretty good job in the Rose Bowl there, pulling up 50-49 against Penn State, my alma mater. So, you know, we see some exciting things in sports, but that translates to the challenges we have in life. So thank you very much, Dr. Joseph Maroon. We love you. Be well. And thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Nick. Take care.
Bye-bye.